Hello, this is Spartan Commander, and this is the 885th Rome Total War Brotherhood game that I've put onto YouTube. Just to give you a little bit of RTW history, approximately 17 years ago, Steve Longshanks and myself bought the 31k rules and armies to RTW. And for the last 17 years, the rules that we bought were very Rome-friendly, because back in the day, most people were playing with Rome. So what we've done recently, we've introduced some new rules to the 31k battlefield, and that is that we've allowed Parthia and Scythia to have 10 cavalry max. As we know that both Parthia and Scythia, it's infantry, no matter how many upgrades you put on them, were very poor, and their strength, obviously are their cavalry. So from now on in the 31k rules, we're going to incorporate 10 cavalry max for Scythia and 10 cavalry max for Parthia, just to bring them onto the battlefield, because how rare is it to see Scythia or Parthia on the 31k battlefield, of course, with the 6 cavalry max that we've had for 17 years. This battle is fought on a custom map. If you just look around, just to show you the map here as we look around, let's say it's a custom flat map. So as I say, we like to play on custom maps. It kind of adds even more to the battles, really. But it is just a flat, if you like, featureless map, really. And as I say, this is a cracking battle for you to watch, and I really hope you enjoy it. Okay, our first teammate is Brotherhood member Man 2, who has bought the Scythian faction. Now, he has got 10 headhunting maidens and 10 archers. We've actually bought in another rule about 6-foot archers max to stop our battles becoming archer fests, if you like. But he didn't hear that bit, and he's bought 10 archers. But the other team has said that they're quite happy for him to use those 10 archers in this battle. So, as I say, he's got 10 headhunting maidens and 10 archers. If you notice there, if you count the upgrades, the headhunting maidens are fully upgraded. Now, just to let you know that, you know, when you hear the name maiden, you might think innocent, you know, a bit quiet, a bit backward, like, you know, they don't want to come forward and things like that. Well, that's certainly not these. These are the deadly ladies of Rome Total War. Okay, just to give you a little bit of history about these ladies there, with their effective against armor axes. Before the last patch came on to Rome Total War, I had a Scythian army of 14 headhunting maidens and 6 chosen archers. And believe me, with that army, I could take out a whole Roman army. That's how tough the headhunting maidens were. Okay, so 14 headhunting maidens, 6 archers, I could take out whole Roman armies. And then they bought the last patch in, and I didn't know that they changed the headhunting maiden specs. And I charged my maidens into the Roman army like I had done before the patch came in, and I lost all my maidens. So the last patch that they bought in on Rome Total War weakened the headhunting maidens now. But saying that, cavalry versus cavalry, I still think these headhunting maidens are probably the best cavalry in the game at cavalry versus cavalry. But as I say, headhunting maidens, they certainly aren't maidens. These are the deadly ladies of Rome Total War. And as I say, cavalry versus cavalry, I would say they're probably still the best cavalry in the game. And they already got the chosen archers there of Scythia. They got long range, good defense, and they're so good when they run out of arrows, you can use them as light infantry. So there you are, that's a pretty good Scythian army there, I think, of Man 2s. And don't forget, all these armies for Parthia and Scythia are going to be experimental now. Our next teammate is Brotherhood member Fesson. Now, Fesson's got 11 infantry, 5 archers, and 4 cavalry. Now, he's got some interesting upgrades on his infantry. Can you see some of his infantry have got 8 upgrades? 2 experience stripes, gold shield, gold attack. How often do you see that on a 31k battlefield? And several of his units have got 8 upgrades, 2 experience stripes, gold shield, gold attack. Others of his units have just got gold shield, gold attack on them. I presume they would be his pilot shield units there, but he's certainly got mixed really good upgrades through his infantry. Okay, which tells me that he hasn't probably spent much money on his cavalry. I'm thinking just gold shield, just gold shield, gold attack on his cavalry there. So I think that's an interesting Roman army there of Fesson's. Be interesting to see how well he does with that. Okay, our next teammate is Brotherhood member Eth. Now, Eth apologised to the team before the battle started because he has rarely bought Seleucid in the past and he is really not very confident with Pike factions. But he wants to get better with Pike factions so that, you know, that old saying about practice makes perfect. So he's bought this Seleucid faction here. And he has got 12 pikes, 2 archers, and 5 cataphracts. There you can see he's got 7 upgrades on his pikes. There, if you look, there you are. He's got 7. An experience stripe, gold shield, gold attack on his pikeman there. And it'd be interesting to see what upgrades he's put on his cataphracts. So I would think probably quite good upgrade. Yeah, 8 upgrades, 2 experience stripes, gold shield, gold attack. As we've talked about in the past, we call these guys the tanks of the ancient world because they're armored from head to toe, and used properly, they can be battle-winning troops there. Okay, so, and then he's got a chariot unit there. As we've said before, big attacking specifications, big fear factor, but of course, if they run amok, they kill both friend and foe alike. And I always say to people, if you're not confident, if you're not competent, you might want to really think hard before you bring chariots, because if they start chopping down your allies' troops, you become unpopular quite quickly there. So there's Eth's experimental Seleucid army. As I say, he apologized to us before we even started the battle for if we lose, he's going to say it's all his fault. And our last teammate is myself. Spartan Commander's got a very old Roman army of 15 infantry and 4 cavalry. Okay, just like to show you here, I've got 2 morale boosting eagle units within this old army. Okay, they can prove very useful. And of course, I've got my general morale bonus as well. So I've got a lot of morale going on in my army. Quite a diverse team. We got Scythia, we got Rome, we've got Seleucid, and we've got Rome. A very, very good battle this is, and I hope you enjoy it. And here is the other team. We have RTW player Lando. Now, Lando's got the bog standard 31k Roman army of 14 infantry and 6 cavalry. Okay, so 14 infantry and 6 cavalry is the bog standard 31k Roman army, and that's because it's so effective and so efficient. Their next teammate is Brotherhood member TR, who has bought the Parthia faction. Now, he's got 5 archers, 1 slinger, 10 cavalry, 3 infantry. So he's got a very diverse Parthian army. So remember, we've bought in 10 cavalry max for Parthia and Scythia. If you have a look here, slingers. How often do you see Parthian slingers on the 31k battlefield? I would suggest that would be very, very rare. And there you've got horse archer unit there. So they're very good. Those, if you check the specifications of those, they're pretty good there. Then you've got the archers. Now, if you notice here, he's fully upgraded them. 3 experience stripes, gold shield, gold attack. But unfortunately, these archers here, they've got a medium range. Their defense is very poor. Okay, he's fully upgraded them, so he's going to get the most out of them that he can. But to be honest with you, they are quite poor archers there. So to fully upgrade them, that's probably a good thing to do. Just to get most out of them there. Let's say 9 upgrades, 3 experience stripes, gold shield, gold attack. And there you are, he's got an armored Eastern general there. Check the specifications of these units. I think they've got 2 hit points. Really tough cavalry units, these guys are. And then, of course, he's got his cataphracts there. Okay, and he's got 8 upgrades on his cataphracts, 2 experience stripes, gold shield, gold attack. As we said before, with the Seleucid cataphracts, these are the tanks of the ancient world, armored from head to toe. But also, if you notice here, he's got camel cataphracts as well. Okay, they've got the same specifications as the cataphract cavalry there. And also here, you'll see that he's got Eastern infantry. Okay, now, if you notice there, he's fully upgraded those Eastern infantry, and players used to call these guys the pajama people, because if you look closely, it looks like they've just got out of bed, kept their pajamas on, grabbed a spear and a shield, and gone straight into battle. So as I say, these Eastern infantry were referred to as the pajama people back in the day. So it's an old school, old fashioned term, but that's what people used to say about them. But also, I'd like to show you something also a bit old fashioned and old school. Is a unit here called the Hillman unit. Okay, now if you notice, if you read it, you'll see it's light infantry, but we found back in the day that these Hillmen were better Okay, they fought better and lasted longer than those Eastern infantry, even though the Eastern infantry were 120-man units, and these are only 80-man units. So the Hillmen definitely seemed better than the Eastern infantry there. Okay, so that's a very diverse Parthian army that TR has got there. Be interesting to see how well he does with them. Okay, their next teammate is Brotherhood member Barclay Mann. That's got his faction of choice, which is Pontus. Now, he's got 12 pikes, 2 archers, 4 chariots, and 2 cavalry. Check the upgrades on his pikes there. You'll see they've got 8 upgrades, 2 experience stripes, gold shield, gold attack. And, of course, you've got to fight down the length of those pikes to kill the man on the other end. 8 upgrades is pretty good. Let's say he's got 4 chariots. Remember these chariots here? Big attacking specifications and big fear factor, but of course, like we've talked about on so many occasions, if they run amok, they become a menace to both friend and foe alike, because they kill both friend and foe alike. And you're going to witness something like about that a little bit later on in the battle. And here you'll see he's got 2 cavalry units here, Eastern general units here. These guys have got 2 hit points, and you just check the specifications of those units. They are pretty tough cavalry units. And their last teammate is a Brotherhood member Aurelius, who has unusually bought the Macedon faction. Now, he's got 9 pikes, 5 archers, and 5 cavalry. Okay, if you check here, you'll see that his forward units of his battle formation has only got 4 upgrades on. I'm guessing that's gold defense and a bronze attack. If you move further back, you'll see that he has got the optimum upgrades on the Macedonian Royal Pikeman. 8 upgrades, 2 experience stripes, gold shield, gold attack. That is the optimum upgrades on Royal Pikeman there of Macedon. He's got 5 archers there for good firepower. Be interested to see the upgrade. Oh my gosh, 8 upgrades on his companion cavalry, 2 experience stripes, gold shield, gold attack. Remember, we've talked about these before. They're very often called the winged horsemen because of those wings on their helmets. And don't forget, they've got a 9 charge bonus as well. Remember, that's the impact and penetration that a cavalry unit can do there. So there you are, there's the enemy team, very diverse. You've got Rome with Lando. Okay, you've got Parthia with TR. You've got Pontus with Barclay Mann, and you've got Macedon with Aurelius. Should be a great one to watch. Okay, at this stage of the battle, you'll notice that I've moved my Bruttii army from the left flank to forward, into the centre, if you like. And you can see that Fesen has put his archers out the front as well. And this is to protect our Seleucid ally, Eth-Eth. Remember, the enemy archers, they've got a lot of elite enemy archers there, which would like to target Eth-Eth Seleucid units. Remember, those big 121-man units are extremely susceptible to any kind of missile damage. And of course, our Roman troops will suffer absolute minimum loss head-on against archers. So you'll notice, as I say, both Fesen and myself have moved out in front of Eth-Eth there to try and cover his 121-man units from any missiles that we can. Okay, at this stage of the battle, I want to show you an old-school tactic here by TR. Can you see he's throwing that cheap peasant unit out the front of his battle formation there in the hope that one of us will have our archers on auto-fire and we'll waste our expensive archer arrows on that cheap peasant unit. So it's an old-school tactic. You don't see it used that much, but throwing a peasant unit out in front of your main army sometimes can catch enemy troops out if they've got their archers on auto-fire, and of course you waste your expensive arrows on the cheapest unit in the game. Okay, at this very, very early stage of the battle, as I say, you can see TR has put that peasant unit out in open order, and just waiting for to see if any of us will be shooting our expensive arrows at that particular unit. Over here you'll see TR has put that horse archer unit into Cantabrian Circle. Very difficult to kill when a horse archer unit goes into Cantabrian Circle for foot archers. And you can see here that TR is putting his I think that's a slinger unit there forward. Yep, there you go. As I say, very, very unusual to see a Parthian slinger unit on a 31k battlefield there. But they can be very effective as well, slinger units can be. And as I say, if you notice here, I think the enemy team are going to put their cheap Parthian archers and slinger units forward for us to shoot with our expensive arrows onto those cheap archer and slinger units there, keeping their more elite archers at the back. Pause the game for a second. So, as I say, you've got the peasant unit, slinger units, and the archer units of Parthia cheap there. And what they want to do is for us to shoot our expensive arrows from our expensive archers into those cheap units. Well, if you notice here, they're keeping their elite Cretan archers at the rear of the Parthian units there. And remember that those Cretan archers have got long range as well. So make no mistake, they will be shooting lots of arrows into our team. And I think you'll remember on this particular map, I think that Team 2 might have a slight height advantage. I could be wrong there, but I think the Team 2 might have a slight height advantage there. So, of course, their Cretan archers' arrows will go further and do more damage there. But as I say, here you can see Fesson's archers here. As I say, both Fesson and myself are going to do our best to try and stop our Seleucid ally Eth's units, you know, being damaged too much by missile fire, if we possibly can there. And over here, as I say, you've got the Cretan archers there, long range, very and they're quite fast shooting as well, the Cretan archers. But as I say, I think the enemy team have made a good move in putting the cheap Parthian missile units out front, so that we will be using our expensive arrows on them. As I say, Seleucid archers aren't very good either, mind. So Seleucid archers are only medium range and poor defense as well. They're kind of on a par with the Parthian foot archers. So you can see here that Mantu is moving his elite chosen archers forward there. I'm presuming he's probably going to target the Cretan archers there of Aurelius's Macedonian units there. And this is a nice little move here by, I think it's Barclay Man, with that fast moving Eastern General unit there. Oh my gosh, look at that, straight in, routed. Routed units, look, and then it's going to clear off quickly, look, before we can get to him. There you are, that one unit. I think he routed two other archer units as well, but he's also routed these three archer units as well with that one fast-moving cavalry unit there. So that was a nice aggressive attacking move there, and maybe we should have been a bit more switched on to see that coming, to counter him with our cavalry there. So really well done there to Barclay Man. With that fast-moving unit. Here you'll see that Mantu is now counter-attacking with his headhunting, his fast-moving headhunting maidens, like a bang, as he charges into the Parthian archers there. Now you can see TR bringing his cavalry out. Now that would be an interesting battle, wouldn't it? The headhunting maidens against those well-upgraded Parthian cavalry there. But you can see that Mantu's pulled his headhunting maidens back there. Okay, you can see them pull, he's pulled them back away from those Parthian cavalry. But also you've got Eth's well upgraded cataphracts there as well. Now would it be worth the two of them charging their cavalry forward into these Parthian units? Or the only trouble is the Macedonian pikes are not far behind, but I was just thinking, I wonder if Eth and Mantu, if they charge their cavalry, could do a lot of damage to those Parthians before the Macedonian pikes got there. Just a thought there. Over here, as you can see, I've really moved my Brutii troops forward there to try and push back the enemy archers. That's why I've moved my infantry so far forward, to try and push back the enemy archers, stop them targeting our Seleucid ally. As I say, the big 121 man units are very, very susceptible to any kind of missile damage there. So that's why I've moved my my infantry forward there, just to try and push back the enemy archers so that they can't target our Seleucid ally as much as they would like to do. You can see both Fesson and myself moving our infantry forward. And over here you'll see TR's got his cavalry ready there. That would be a really interesting tussle there to see those cavalry against Scythian headhunting maidens. Don't forget these companion cavalry have got 8 upgrades on. 2 experience stripes, gold shield, gold attack. They've got good specifications as well. So as I say here, this is a really exciting and interesting battle, as you will see when it actually kind of gets into the hand-to-hand fighting mode there. As you can see, Mantu's taking his chosen archers forward. As I say, he'll probably be targeting enemy missile troops there. You can see there's not a lot of TR's men left in this particular unit. They've been targeted quite well. As I say, as we saw earlier, he fully upgraded his archer units just to try and get the most out of them that he can. And you can see here probably Mantu targeting them. But what Mantu obviously would like to do is take out the enemy missile troops and then concentrate his archer fire onto the Macedonians or Pontus and pikemen there, or, you know, both if he can, to weaken them before we actually get into hand-to-hand fighting. Okay, you can see there that Mantu's just moved his headhunting maidens forward there to support his archers, just in case the enemy were thinking of running any cavalry units forward to try and attack his archer units. There you are, he's got his 10 headhunting maidens there, ready to, ready for action, really. As I say, it would be an interesting little tussle there. And you can see the Seleucid cataphracts in behind the headhunting maidens there to support if need be. But it would be an interesting tussle there to see the Parthian cavalry against the headhunting maidens. Now over here on our left flank, you'll see that Barclayman has slowly moved around a couple of chariots there that, make no mistake, are loitering with intent. And their intent there, I think, is to smash into the flank of my Brutii infantry, preferably when I'm engaged with enemy troops there, so I'm pinned and held. That's probably what he's looking at there, to smash into the flank of my engaged infantry. Now over here you'll see Fesson has been very aggressive with his infantry. Remember, he's got very, very good upgrades on his infantry there, and he's moving them towards the enemy troops. I'm now moving my Brutii troops forward as well there. And if you notice, I've got my Brutii army on a slight angle there, and that's to try and neutralize the chariot attack that might come in on my flank. Okay, you'll notice I'm not facing Lando's army head on. Here you can see the Cretan archers still shooting into us. They'll be targeting poor old Eth's Seleucid pikeman there, so he's not going to want to stand around getting shot to pieces. So I think we're going to have to be aggressive and attack here. As I say, the enemy archers will be targeting his units. And as I say, you can see those two chariots out there ready to possibly attack the flank of my infantry when I get engaged with Lando's infantry, I think. You'll see here that I've got my cavalry locked and loaded, ready to try and help my infantry against the chariots. So you'll see that Eth's got a pike wall there with one of his pike units there, kind of protect us a little bit from the chariot attack. As you can see, I've moved my Brutii infantry forward once again here, chasing back enemy archers. They're trying to put them out of range of our Seleucid ally. But as I say, I think we are going to have to attack here simply because of the damage that our Seleucid ally is taking. As I say, you've got those two chariot units. Pause the game for a second here. So if we look over here, what I was thinking here is if Mantu moved his chosen archers out, he could fire arrow those chariots. Now remember, fire arrows panic those chariots and would make them run amok. And what I would be hoping was if he could make them run amok, they would run amok into the enemy troops and start chopping down enemy troops. That's what I would hope would happen here. So if Mantu moves those chosen archers out a little bit more to the left, and then fire arrow those chariots, we could well maybe make them run amok and hopefully not run into our troops and run into their troops. But with run amok chariots, they go in any direction, so it'll be interesting to see. As I say, here you'll see these elite Cretan archers of Aurelius are definitely targeting Eth's Seleucid pike units there. So Eth now, I think he did say to us, you know, we need to attack, I'm being shot to pieces here. So I think, you know, this is what we're going to have to do. The enemy archers, I don't think, they're not targeting our archers anymore. They're just targeting poor old Eth's Seleucid pike units there. Right, now over here on our left flank, you'll notice that Mantu has moved his entire army over from the right flank to the left flank here. Okay, he's got all 10 of his headhunting maidens, and the archers that he's got left, all the archery units he's got left, he's moving over to the left. And this is what I'm thinking that he's thinking, what we talked about earlier here. He's going to get his archers in range of those chariots and fire arrow them and try and get them to run amok. Okay, that's why I think Mantu's moved all his units over from right to left. Okay, but here you can see both myself and Fesson have moved forward very aggressively here. Now you'll see that Fesson is really pushing his infantry into this one Pontus pike unit here. Now what he'd like to do is obviously take that pike unit out. Okay, that's what he'd like to do, is take this pike unit out and then get in range of the Pontus pikes and throw all his pilers into the forward units of those Pontus pikes before he gets into hand-to-hand combat to weaken them, and hopefully they would rout during the course of the hand-to-hand fight in there. But as I say, you can see we're quite kind of bunched there, and if all these enemy troops, all those Macedonian troops and all this enemy cavalry came round our flank, can you see how exposed our right flank is now? Can you see that? I mean, if the enemy troops get organized, they could really cause us problems there on our right flank. Okay, you can see FS set out a couple of pike walls there to try and protect our rear a little bit. But as I say, the enemy on our right flank, if they got organized there, I think could cause us some problems. Okay, so as I say, here you can see Mantu moving his long range chosen archers out here, I think with a view to fire arrowing those chariots. Okay, now as I say, you can see my army here facing Lando's blue Scipio army. And as I say, you can see Fesson there. He's finally broken that one Pontus pike unit that he was attacking. But you can see my units here moving forward on to Lando's units. There's probably going to be some pilot exchanging going on here. There you are. You can see here, because I moved and Lando was just stood still there, he got the first pilers into my troops. Because obviously my troops won't throw in their pilers till they've actually stopped moving. So that kind of gives the advantage to the enemy troops that are just standing there. Right. Okay, so as I say, here you can see Mantu here is now fire arrowing, not using ordinary arrows. Please notice that. He is fire arrowing the chariots there to try and get them to run amok. Okay, remember when they run amok, they go out completely out of their general's control and they just attack anything that's near them, friend or foe alike. And that's what Mantu's trying to do here. Obviously, Barclay Man hasn't noticed that these chariots are being fire arrowed at this stage, because otherwise he would have moved them out of the way. I'm really surprised that these chariots here that have just been hit by a volley of fire arrows haven't run amok yet. Because very, very often, one volley from two or three archer units will get a chariot unit to run amok. So I think Barclay Man's very lucky at the moment that these chariots haven't run amok. And now he's seen the fire arrows coming in on them. So he is now moving those chariots away from Mantu's archers there. But as I say, fire arrows will make these type of chariots run amok there. So it'd be interesting to see what happens there. Right, you can see here that Lando is moving towards my green Brutio army. Pause the game for a second here. Okay, so you can see we are really bunched here. Can you see both Fesson and myself, we're trying to kind of defend our Seleucid ally from missiles there, but now you can see we're bunched. Look at that Scipio cavalry ready to come in, and all these enemy troops now, look, because we're bunched, can come round and smash us in the flank. So I don't think things looking very good for our team at this stage. Okay, our right flank to me looks very, very exposed. But over here, oh my gosh, good news for us. This chariot here has run amok. Now, what we're hoping for is that that chariot will, in its amok mode, run into enemy troops. But unfortunately, it looks like it's heading away from the enemy troops there. But that's what we would have been hoping for, is the amok chariot to run into run into the enemy troops there and cause them a lot of casualties. Now, we're still fire arrowing this one chariot unit here. So there might be a chance, possibly, that this unit might run amok. I can see that Barclay Man's running that chariot unit over towards my infantry. Can you see? He wants to hit my infantry. Can you see? I'm moving my infantry over a little bit there. But hopefully this chariot might run amok before it hits me. Here we go. You can see that chariot's being hit by lots of fire. Right, there you are. Can you see the banner is now glowing red? That unit is now run amok. Now, what I'm hoping, I'll just pause the game for a second here. So what I'm hoping now, and what the whole team is hoping, is that this amok chariot's going to run into Lando Scipioi infantry. That would be great from our point of view. Meanwhile, over here, you'll see that Fesson's been hit by Scipioi infantry, and I believe Scipioi cavalry has hit him as well. Plus, you've got Pontus Pikes coming in on him. So remember, Fesson's infantry were very, very well upgraded, but he has taken a lot of punishment where he is there. And you can see all the enemy troops there building up that, as I say, could well try a right flanking action on us there. We are a bit bunched, as you can see. But as I say, this run-amuck chariot. Now, we know we've talked about run-amuck chariots loads in our battle videos, haven't we? And how much of a nuisance they can be and a menace to both friends and foe alike. So watch this amuck chariot. See there. Now, remember that Lando is Barclay Mann's ally. So the Scipioi, the blue Scipioi troops are Barclay Mann's Pontus ally here. And look at this amok chariot smashing in to Lando's infantry, chopping down Lando's infantry there. Just look at that. And that's why I say bringing chariots is a real double-edged sword. Just look how that amok chariot is killing loads of Lando's infantry there. And look, that chariot's still going. It's going into actually the Pontus Pikes themselves and moving into the Pontus Archers. Just look, that chariot has just smashed through, that amok chariot has just smashed through its allies' troops here, chopping down loads of infantry. Most of those Scipioi infantry that you see are dead there have been killed by that amok chariot. And that amok chariot now, look, is heading in to Parthian cavalry. Oh my gosh. And don't forget, we think that amok chariots are stronger than they are in normal mode. But meanwhile here, you can see enemy troops moving towards us here on the right flank. You can see a couple of Fesson's units have been routed. He's been hit by cavalry and infantry there. So that's why his units are starting to rout. So, as I say, you can see the enemy troops coming round our right flank here. And as I say, it's a chariot unit around there as well. Our right flank to me looks a little bit exposed. I don't know what all of you watching this think. I can see here that Eth's moving some of his pike units over there. But oh my gosh, look at that amok chariot still killing its allies' troops. Oh my gosh. And I just wanted to show you something here. So that amok chariot's just been through the Parthian cavalry. See all these dead armored Parthian cavalry camels there? They've just been killed by that amok chariot. So you can see where none of our troops have killed them. All these dead armored camels there have just been killed by their allies' amok chariot. So that's why I say, you know, before you bring chariots, you need to feel confident and competent. Otherwise, the damage they can do. There you are. Look at these troops here. Look, this is where that chariot smashed through, killing more Scipioi troops, more alloy Scipioi troops there. I just wanted to show you the damage that that amok chariot can do. So, you know, we talked about amok chariots loads in the past, and I just wanted to show you there how devastating amok chariots can be to their allies. Now, you'll notice here, I'm kind of moving my infantry forward in a kind of a surge attack here. What I want to try and do is take a bit of pressure off the other flank. If I can cause problems on this flank, it may well mean that they got to bring reinforcements over from the other flank. Right, over here you'll see that our Seleucid ally Eth has hit those well-upgraded Macedonian companion cavalry there with his cataphracts there. A nice move there by Eth. Now in a minute, something happens on both flanks of this battle, which is difficult to film here. But you can see Eth now with his well-upgraded cataphracts. He may well be looking to smash in to those Parthian infantry over there. Okay, he may well be looking to do that. Now, a man too, see that amok chariot there barking? Now, man too may well want to go over to help Eth, but he can't go directly there, look, because of that amok chariot that would chop up his cavalry. So man too's going to have to go around the long way to go around there to help Eth if he wants to get his cavalry over to help there, because that amok chariot, make no mistake, would chop up loads of Mantu's cavalry if he tried running through it. Okay, so over here on our left flank, you'll see that Lando's brought his cavalry over in wedge formation. Okay, make no mistake there, he's going to smash into the flank of my battle formation there. I've got my four cavalry there ready to try and neutralize as much as I can, and I'm turning an infantry unit to face the threat there as well. Okay, so there you are, you can see Lando's cavalry there. Right, there he goes. Right, he's going to smash in to the flank of my infantry. I've turned units to face that threat, and I'm also going to counterattack with my cavalry, and bang, as his cavalry goes in, and bang, as my cavalry goes in there. Oh my gosh, bang and bang there as we smash in there. You can see that Fessen threw a couple of his battle damaged cavalry in there as well. Right, so as I say, there's something happening on both flanks here. That was Lando's cavalry attack into my infantry, which hopefully I've neutralized with my infantry and cavalry. But over here, you can see here that Aurelius is really pushing in with his fresh Macedonian pike units there. And remember that Macedonian pike units have got a better specification than Seleucid. The Macedonian pikes, I think, have got at least three better defense before you put any upgrades on. Right, so here you'll see that Eth is charging his well-upgraded cataphracts into the Parthian troops there. Okay, he's hit a Parthian cataphract unit here, but you've got two units of the pajama people. They're the Eastern infantry there moving forward with their anti-cavalry spears, and you've got the hillmen with their anti-cavalry spears being thrown in there as well. Plus, you've got other units here that are going to join in to attack Eth's cavalry. Okay, but as I say, Eth's charging those cataphracts in, those well-upgraded cataphracts in, like a bang as he smashes in there. But as I say, he's coming up against a lot of enemy units there. There you can see the camel cataphracts going in, more camel cataphracts going in there as well. Even more coming in. You can see some Scipioi infantry joining in. Here comes some more cataphracts there. Look. And you've got a Pontus cavalry unit charging in there as well. So at the moment, here poor old cavalry are fighting a large amount. He's alt attack there, using his effective against armor maces, but he's coming up against cavalry cataphracts, enemy infantry, Pontus cavalry, and also there's Scipioi infantry being thrown in there as well. Now you can see that Mantu is looks like he's trying to chase off the Macedonian cavalry there, but as I say, Eth here is facing a heck of a lot. I think Eth thought he was only fighting infantry at one stage, those pajama people, but as you can see, there's lots more there. Here you can see Mantu charges maidens in there like a bang as the maidens charge in there. But remember, they're not just up against cavalry here, they're up against anti-cavalry spearmen as well. As I say, cavalry versus cavalry, I reckon the headhunters maidens are the best in the game. But here, as I say, they're fighting infantry as well as cavalry here. Just look at those effective against armor axes there, the damage that they're doing. Oh my gosh, here comes that well-upgraded Macedonian cavalry. That's good, they've taken out the Parthian general, but there goes that, it's a Macedonian cavalry, and bang, as they charge into the maidens. The maidens still holding that. They're being attacked from the front there, and they're being attacked from the rear. The well-upgraded Macedonian companion cavalry coming in from one side, and the Parthian units coming in from there, plus Scipioi infantry coming in there as well. Oh my gosh, see how well the maidens are holding there. See how well those Scythian headhunting maidens are holding against them. Unfortunately, all of Eth's well-upgraded cataphracts have now been routed. Unfortunately for our team, that's bad news for our team here. But as I say, Mantu's doing extremely well there. Just look how well those headhunting maidens are holding. I think that's really great. Now over here, you'll see that I'm surge attacking with my infantry against the Pontus pikemen there. Okay, here you can see that my cavalry are fighting Lando's cavalry there, my green Brutii cavalry there, against the Scipioi cavalry. You can see I've got a Seleucid chariot unit coming in there from Eth, no support there. But you can see my infantry surging forward now. Now the best thing for Mantu now is to pull his cavalry back. There's too much infantry coming in, loads of Scipioi infantry coming in there. So as I say, they're not so good against infantry, the maidens. They're really only good against cavalry. And you can see him pulling back there. So let's just pause the game for a second. Now all these troops here, all these enemy troops here that were sent over, can now come over and attack my Brutii infantry. Okay, most of Fessen's troops have now been taken out. I think he's just got a couple of really battle-damaged units left. And as you can see here, the Macedonian pikes have really pummeled our Seleucid ally there. And you can see that Lando's got a couple of his cavalry units in behind FS pikes as well. So that was a hammer and anvil attack. And as I say here, you can see that most of FS infantry has been taken out by those Macedonian pikes. And I say that that hit in the rear by Lando's cavalry there. So things at the moment not looking very good for our team. As I say here, you can see my green Brutii infantry attacking there. I'd like to take out the Pontus general if I could here. But you can see here, that, and also I've got a chariot unit, a Seleucid chariot unit from FF he sent in as well here, trying to take out these enemy troops. Okay, as I say, I'd like to take out the Pontus general if I could there, and take away the morale bonus if I could. But you can see here that we're really pushing in. I've got my cavalry in there as well as my infantry, just trying to take out that unit. You can see there, oh dear, that's Fessen's general's been taken out. I think basically all of Fessen's troops possibly has been taken out at this stage. And here you can see Mantu's headhunting maidens charging in there like a bang as they smash in there. Right, that's good news for us. That's good news. We've taken out the Pontus general, or we've routed the Pontus general anyway, so we've taken the morale bonus away. So that's good news for us. Okay, you can see here a Seleucid unit taking on a Pontus unit. And also you can see that Mantu's archers here are still shooting into enemy troops there. So well done to Mantu with his archers. Hopefully he's targeting the Macedonians. That's who we want to target there, because that Macedonian army look, still looks pretty well intact to me, trying to take out Seleucid general there. Okay, so here you'll see you've got Pontus pikemen there as well. Pretty good numbers there in those Pontus pike units there as well. So that's bad news for us. And all these Scipio troops and Parthian cavalry there and infantry ready to come in onto my Brutii infantry there. Okay, so as you can see there, it's just a quick look at what's going on around the battlefield. Okay, so what I think what I decided to do at this stage of the battle was trying to take on Lando's Scipii infantry, if I remember correctly. I think there's an Amok chariot there was just running through my infantry there, but there you can see me attacking that one Pontus unit, trying to take out that Pontus pike unit there. That's what I was trying to do. And then, but you can see the Scipii infantry of Lando there. There you are. So now I'm going to switch my attack onto Lando's. Now you can see a couple of cavalry units of Lando's like bang, smashing into my infantry there. But what I'm trying to do there, I want to try and take out Lando's infantry if I can. You'll see I'm charging my cavalry in as well. I'm doing a combined infantry and cavalry attack. And bang! As my cavalry smashes in there. You can see that Parthian cavalry and infantry are being thrown in as well. Now all we want is a Mantu's headhunting maidens to smash in there as well. Oh my gosh, just look at this massive hit. Come on, where's those headhunting maidens? Charge them in there, that's it. And bang, as they smash in there as well. So at the moment, as I say, my battle damaged infantry are fighting Lando's infantry plus Parthian infantry as well. That's good news for us. Lando's general's just been routed, so they've lost the morale bonus from that. You can see me charging what's left of my cavalry in as well. Oh my gosh, we've done really well. That is good news for us. That is really good news if we could just take out those last couple of years. Right, okay, so we've taken out all of Lando's infantry and I think his cavalry as well. I think we've taken out all of Lando's infantry and cavalry. Okay, that was a nice combination hit between Mantu's headhunting maidens, my infantry and cavalry there. But now these Macedonian pike units are going to be a real problem for us. You know, like fighting down those long pikes to kill the man on the other end for Roman infantry is very, very difficult. And I think this could be a problem. The only chance we've got is to maybe to hold and pin those pike units while we get our cavalry in behind them. I think that might be maybe a tactic we may have to look at here. But as I say, you can see there's a lot of enemy pike units there moving towards us there. And they're in numbers as well. They have been battle damaged, but they've still got quite good numbers in those units. Okay, so right, so we're kind of going into the last phase of the battle here. So you can see those Macedonian pikes moving towards us there. And you can see Man 2 looking to get his cavalry in behind the pikes. Can you see that? Okay, so what I'm looking to do is to hit these pikes, try and pin and hold them, while Man 2 gets his cavalry in behind to smash into the rear of those engaged pikemen. Okay, so that's the tactic that we're thinking of. But unfortunately, my infantry is so battle damaged, I haven't got a lot of it left. So whether I'll be able to effectively pin and hold all those Macedonian units, I'm not sure. You can see that Eth's got one of his pike units in there as well, maybe a couple of his pike units in there. I'm charging forward with my infantry. I just want to hold and pin those pike units as much as I can there as we try and charge our cavalry. And you can see my Brutii cavalry charging in there. Look. Okay, so here, as I say, I'm trying to pin and hold those Macedonian units. We've got, as I say, Eth's Seleucid unit. There's a Macedonian general there. I'd love to take the Macedonian general out, take the morale away from the enemy troops there, that morale bonus there that he would be given there. Now here you can see that Man 2 was going to charge his cavalry in, but can you see that Macedonian pike unit has turned to face his cavalry there? Can you see? So he's done the best thing in moving away there. But I can see several of my units starting to rout. I think there's a, oh my gosh, there's enemy cavalry coming in behind me. Oh my gosh, into my tired, battle damaged units. And bang! As that cavalry smashed into the rear of my units. Still, my units are still fighting there. I've only got about 3 units left. Oh my gosh, and you can see Mantu's general's just been killed. As Mantu charges his headhunting maidens there. Look. Oh my gosh, bang! As they smash in there. Oh my gosh. As I say, I've got 3 infantry units left. That's all I've got. I'm charging a couple of battle damaged cavalry units in there as well. I can see some of the Macedonian units starting to rout. Oh my gosh, he's going to go right down to the wire. There's another Parthian cavalry unit smashing in. Oh my God, I think all of Man 2's headhunting maidens have now been routed. I've got 1 unit left, just my general unit left now. That's all I've got. I think that's all we've got in our armies there. And oh my God, it's just been routed. So, well done to the enemy team there. You can see there that I think, well, that's all my army taken out. And I think there might just be a couple of archery units left of Man 2's. There they are. Just a couple of units left. That's all he's got left as well now, 2 or 3 units there. So well done to the enemy team there. They've gone on to win a great battle. But if we look at the battlefield here, you can see how intense the fighting is. There, just look at the dead there. Oh my gosh. You can see just, you know, how intense the fighting was all the way across the battlefield here. Oh my gosh. There's a big pile of red Julii dead there, and you can see that as you move across here, move across the battlefield here. Oh my gosh, look at a load of Julii cavalry taken out there. You can just see that big pile of Julii cavalry there if we move across the battlefield. Over to this area, of course, this is where Seleucid cataphracts there and the headhunting maidens of Man 2 are fighting all those enemy troops, both infantry and cavalry there. Just look at the dead there. Oh my gosh. Just see how many dead were there. And over here, look as well. It just goes to show, doesn't it, how intense the fighting was in this battle here. And I don't think there's a lot of enemy units left. Although, I think if you look at the Macedonians, you can see there's a lot of them left. But I don't think there's a lot of enemy troops left in general. There, you can see Man 2 here. Looks like he's going to try and take out that Macedonian cavalry unit there. It wouldn't surprise me if Mastodon got some good kills, because the Macedonian general killed a lot of the big 121-man Seleucid pike units there. So it wouldn't surprise me if Aurelius got some really good kills in this battle there. So I would think Man 2 would probably admit defeat. Let's just pause the game for a second here. So I just wanted to show you here, I think that TR has just got 2 very battle damaged units left. So that's TR's, that's all he's got left in his whole army. And I think Lando's only got 2 very, very battle damaged units left as well. In fact, I think, yeah, there's only one of his units, he's only got 1 man in that. Can you see? Just 1 man in that unit. So that just goes to show how attritional this battle was. And I think all of Barclay Man's units have been taken out. all of the Pontus units of Barclay Manlet have been completely taken out in this game, but you can see there are a lot of Macedonian units left. Yes, they are battle damaged, but there are a lot of Macedonian units left there. And I think Mantu's just admitted defeat, so here we go. Well done to the enemy team. The first thing I'd like to say is really well played to everybody in the game. I thought this was a cracking battle here. And only the second battle we've played with 10 Cavmax for Parthia and Scythia. And as you can see, it was a close defeat for us. So well done to both teams. And the highest kills in the game, surprisingly, goes to myself. It's very rare these days for me to get the highest kills, but to get over 2,000 kills is extra rare for me these days. So I was really pleased with that. You know, I thought that was, as I say, it's very, very rare. So, oh yeah, I was very pleased with that number of kills. So well done to a Brotherhood member, Aurelius. Great kills there with Macedon. As I said, I thought he'd get some good kills there with the damage that his Cretan archers, his cavalry and his pikes were doing to the Seleucids especially. Well done to him. Well done to Barclay Man. Got some good kills with his faction of choice, Pontus. Well done to TR with that experimental Parthian army. And well done to Lando. Got some good kills. So really well played, guys. That was a great battle there. Really well done. Well done to Eth. Got over 1,000 kills with that experimental Seleucid army. So well done to Eth there. As I say, that was experimental. And he apologised to us. Remember before the beginning of the battle, if we lost it, he said it was all his fault. Fesson, he got less than 1,000 kills. So he'll be a bit disappointed with his kills. But he was very aggressive with his army. And well done to Mantu with that experimental Scythian army there. Look at the kills he got with that. So really well done there. And look at the faction. Anybody got faction advantage, you think? The enemy team had Macedon, Pontus, Parthia and Rome. Do you think that gave them a faction advantage? We had Rome, Seleucid, Rome and Scythia. So do you think either team had a faction advantage there? So as you can see here, we've introduced some new rules there. 10 Cav Max for Scythia and 10 Cav Max for Parthia. And we think this added an extra exciting dynamic thing to our battles like through doing that. And I hope you agree. Please leave your thoughts in the comments. I'd be very interested to see, to read what you think about this battle. Remember, we play every Friday, Saturday and Sunday. See you soon.